afternoon of panels with a very engaging topic, which is the cultural formation and the arts, and with very interesting speakers. Probably they are all very well known to you since they are all DSPT fellows and extremely talented professionals. I encourage you to check our website, this website on the College of Fellows. You want to learn more about their background and their expertise. Our first speaker is Professor Philip Bess, who teaches architecture at the University of Notre Dame. And Professor Bess is particularly interested in Catholic and classical humanistic intellectual and artistic traditions in dialogue with contemporary culture in urban design. And hopefully we will now be able to hear some about that. Welcome, please, Professor Bess.
Thank you very much. I want to thank everyone responsible for putting this conference on, because it's really great, and I just think it's going to get better. I hope it keeps on getting better. But I want to say that I'm temperamentally inclined to pessimism, and my Catholic faith encourages me to be hopeful. But on November 3rd, something happened that none of you in your lifetime have seen, that I've been waiting all my life to see, and of course it's the Cubs won the World Series for the first time since 1908. So that has brightened my outlook, even in the gloom. So I want to invite you to consider the state of knowledge in the fields of architecture and urbanism, and its significance for cultural formation and evangelization, and of course, in 10 minutes, that's the challenge. So regarding cultural formation, for mere succinctness, I cite Winston Churchill's offering during the debates in London about how exactly to rebuild the Parliament buildings damaged by Nazi bombers during the Blitz, in the course of which Sir Winston advocated the reconstruction of Parliament to its previous form by arguing famously that, quote, we shape our buildings and then they shape us, end quote. An argument with which I agree, but to which I would add, and then we shape our buildings and then they shape us, and then we shape our buildings and then they shape us, et cetera. From age to age, the same. Regarding evangelization, I note some other familiar words from a gifted theologian subsequently called to other duties. The only really effective apologia for Christianity comes down to two arguments, namely the saints the church has produced and the art which has grown in her womb. Better witnesses born to the Lord by the splendor of holiness and art than by the clever excuses which apologetics has come up with to justify the dark sides which sadly are so frequent in the church's human history, end quote. Visual is very important. Now, we can be confident that Joseph Ratzinger believes apologetics, properly understood, both is and serves an end higher than clever excuses. And yet, is it not striking that this champion and defender of the importance of truth, and surely to the power of truth, suggests that resplendent goodness and resplendent beauty bear even more effective witness to the Lord? This clarifies a critical element of the vocation of artists in particular, that contrary to what we are sometimes encouraged to think, excellence in an art truly is best understood as evangelization. The artist's evangelical method, however, is of a certain kind, the form of which differs from the discursive evangelization of the preacher or the theologian. The artist serves beauty and the theologian serves truth, but each in their vocation work in service to God and for the glorification of God. So what's the specific vocation of an architect who perforce is also a knowing or unknowing urbanist. Architecture has multiple ends, often in tension. Let me mention three. One can be defined with reference to a patron who commissions an architect to design a building, to whom the architect has an obligation to address the variety of practical and formal issues important to the patron. A second end can be defined with reference to the architectural community itself and its own internal history and standards of excellence. These standards include not only the classical Vitruvian architectural virtues of durability, convenience, beauty, and decorum, but also particular works of architecture that function as iconic and authoritative points of reference for architects, first to emulate, and then, if they are good enough, to surpass. For architects, this second end is primarily aesthetic rather than pragmatic. And although the aesthetic concerns of architects cannot supersede in importance the pragmatic concerns of their patrons, for if they did, much less architecture would actually get built, aesthetic concerns are nevertheless the essence of architecture and distinguish architecture from mere building, to which architecture is nevertheless at all times intrinsically connected. Yet a third end of architecture, beyond the good of the patron, beyond the good of the community of architects, is the good of the city. Indeed, this third end is implied in the architectural virtue of decorum, the virtue that unites patrons and the community of architecture with that larger community, which is the city. But this third end implies, again, something else and something more, that architecture is not only an end in itself, but also a contributing means to some higher end, as well as one tangible manifestation of that higher end. This higher end is the good life for human beings, and in an even more direct and fundamental way, the good life for human beings is also the end for which both the city and the architecture within it exist. Now, I trust you recognize the Aristotelian structure of this account of the multiple telloi of architecture and urbanism, its consonance with the Catholic understanding of human nature, the city of man, and the city of God, and that this way of thinking about architecture and urbanism has occupied a central place in the imagination of historic Western civilization. Nevertheless, today, both knowledge of and belief in these traditional canons of architectural knowledge are, at best, unevenly distributed. In neither the Architectural Academy nor the culture at large does this traditional way of thinking about architecture and urbanism predominate. Modern life is more motion than calm, more mobility than place. It institutionalizes the disposable over the durable, the temporal over the timeless, novelty over beauty. Our views today of architecture and urbanism are utilitarian and individualistic. All of these have affected our teaching institutions, but most importantly, their effects are visible in the environments we make now and have been making for the last 70 years. This is not to say that traditional architecture and urbanism are completely absent from our lives, if only because that was the built environment that existed prior to 1945, and it was built pretty well. But much of that more traditional built environment, at least in America, has been demolished or abandoned in the succeeding seven decades. And it's not that traditional architecture and urbanism are not popular. Indeed, what remains of it has been saved, what remains of it that has been saved and restored is so popular as to be unaffordable by any but the wealthy, unaffordable to any but the wealthy. Nevertheless, for the most part, traditional architecture and urbanism today is an architecture and urbanism we consume rather than an architecture and urbanism we make, which we also have been exporting, the architecture that we now make, we've been exporting to much of the world. Nor is traditional architecture and urbanism completely absent from our schools, as 25 years of Notre Dame architecture graduates can attest. They all get jobs, by the way, too. But it's true that Notre Dame is an extreme outlier. It's also possible that contemporary architecture schools of all intellectual and aesthetic persuasions may be living on borrowed time. Though it's hopeful to recall that arguably the most beautiful architecture and most beautiful cities in the world have been designed by architects who were not taught in schools. But it's true. But who learned their craft as working artists within a larger culture of good building. That indeed is my hope for our Notre Dame graduates, that we have equipped them well to live in a world necessarily more local than global, where in patient daily craftsmanship they can do good work and plant the seedlings for a more beautiful world that gladdens their neighbors and glorifies God. One of the basic outlines of the program there, two marching orders. First, do no harm. And then the second is don't teach anything that has to be unlearned. So in preparation for today, I went back and I watched Dana Joya's wonderful talk from 2 years ago on Catholic imagination and contemporary culture. It's really great. You should all go back and watch it. And I want to conclude with something that Dana said in the Q&A session, actually in response to a question from Ron. So Dana said at the time, he said, in case anybody doesn't know this, it does not help you as an artist to identify yourself as a Catholic. At the best, it's considered a social disease. At worst, a kind of tremendous moral failing. My motto really is that Catholic artists should say, we're here, we're queer, we're not going away. I tip my hat to Dana because he got a laugh with it back then as well. So he continues, there's a time when we simply have to step forward. If you don't witness the truth, it can't be very true to you. It can't be very important to you. My experience has been that once you begin to articulate something, it gives other people the courage to come behind it. I believe that as Catholic artists, and he said Catholic writers, but I'm plugging in the word artists. I believe that as Catholic artists, we need to create a big tent, nourish our own community, start our own conversations, and then just see where it goes. So I think the time, still quoting Dana, so I think the time has come that we have to step forward and be public.
Thank you very much, Professor Bess. Our next speaker is Ron Austin, that as you know very well, he's been a writer and producer in Hollywood for over 50 years, as well as member of the, let's see if I get it right, Academy of Motion Pictures Arts and Sciences, as well as the Directors Guild. And he has published a lot and lecture also in the relationship of faith and the media arts. Welcome.
Well, thank you. You should be alarmed that I don't have a text with me, but I wouldn't be able to read it if I had it, so. And I must start with both an admission and an apology. Manuel told me I would be speaking, and I've been thinking about what I should say, and I was still thinking about it last night, and I think I should have changed it after lunch. So this is going to be a little sketchy and improvisational. But given my background, I want to talk about popular culture and mass media. Gabriel Meyer and I were part of a group that sponsored a reading and lecture by Robert Pinsky, the poet laureate, last week at Mount St. Mary's in Los Angeles. And Robert, beyond reading his wonderful poetry, posed a question of what role culture, in this sense he was speaking more narrowly of the arts, might play in bringing us together. and seeing that I feel we all recognize our obligation as Catholics to be playing some kind of a mediating role in the messy world that we're in now, I took this question very seriously as an obligation. What kind of role can popular culture play? Robert felt it could play perhaps a major role in some way. Now, I'm not a scholar, and I'm not going to get semantically picky here, but I do want to pick on the word culture a little bit. You know, in 1946, T.S. Eliot, in addressing the question of culture, cautioned that anyone that uses the word culture should be obliged to both define it and give an example. Now, that was in 1946, and I think the problem is perhaps even more acute now because I think it is a terribly misused word. Now, you'll be relieved to know I'm not going to try and define it, but let me suggest what some of the characteristics that would normally we would associate with culture, popular or otherwise. Continuity, organic, habitual, I mean, we have habits and customs. It usually has a transcendent origin of some sort, usually religion. But it's organic that it grows and lives. It's a way that we live. It's the way that we think. I don't think we've got a culture in America right now. Not in terms of a popular culture. We have remnants of some. We have pockets of some. But the generational breakdown alone, as I think certainly since the 60s, is questioned when we use the word good, whether we're talking about behavior or art, we may know what we mean and we may respect each other here that based on taste and background, we may agree, but I think it's shooting a blank with most people. Alistair McIntyre described our moral philosophy in America at the end of the 70s as emotivism, that is simply strong subjective emotion as the basis of moral judgment for even educated Americans. Thank God we've at least got that. So I'm going to posit that one of the problems we face if we're going to use popular culture is we're going to have to figure out what it means and perhaps how to begin to create or reinvigorate it. Again, I'm not a scholar. I'm not going to do any kind of historical analysis, but what happened? How did we get to this point of chaos? Incidentally, I'm not going to speak about politics because I think politics is symptomatic in all respect to the seriousness of those of you who have made political commitments. I don't think the real problem right now is the culture or lack of culture beneath. It's the lack of moral coherence that is creating the chaos in politics. That's my view. How did this happen? How did we get to where we are? Well, in the first place, the breakdown of the family. I'm preaching to the choir here, so I don't need to elaborate on that. But once you see this kind of fragmentation of the American family, the family is the social unit of culture and society. Once that begins to fragment, you're going to have further fragmentation as well. I think also in my lifetime, and I'm speaking about a half a century, the second half of the 20th century, the prolongation of wars, and I'm not speaking politically as to whether they were justified or not, from Korea to Vietnam to interventions around the world, to the Middle East, there's never been a real resolution. There's never been a sense of catharsis. There's never been a sense of ultimate meaning for most of us in this. And I think that has seriously undercut the credibility of our leaders. And I'm not making a judgment on them, but I think the moral authority of our national leaders have been undercut by that. But the main culprit, if we want to talk about the prevalence of incoherence and fragmentation is the mass media. So this is a little bit of a repentance, a little mea culpa on my part in that I spent more than 30 years producing work for the mass media. I think the mass media has been the dominant factor in the last half century in shaping the way Americans think and behave to a great extent. And it's not a matter of content, It's a matter of a mode of perception. I mean, McLuhan went into this, Father Ong, there's been many scholars that have looked at the medium, is the message, is the way that you perceive things. When you look at television and movies, particularly over a prolonged period of time, the first thing to recognize is that even if it's a very serious, good film, it almost never has adequate context. It's almost always a radical discontinuity in it. There is also, and my friend Gil Bailey can elaborate on the ideas of René Girard, the use of the scapegoat. There's always someone to blame. Good movies almost have someone to blame in them, even good movies. So polarity, discontinuity, fragmentation, and polarity just go with the territory of it. I can give you some examples of this. Of the attitude. Again, I'm not looking for culprits here. I'm not looking for the people I knew and worked with, I loved and respected for the most part. Nobody was trying to fragment American society. But what we were in the business. We were in a business. We were making commodities. And one of the finest directors I worked with, like pontificate a little bit, he said, you know what we're doing? We're selling emotion. That's what we're selling to the American people. We're selling them emotion. And then a producer who wasn't perhaps quite as intellectual, but very, very successful, also gave us a lecture on what was needed for a good script and a good movie. He said, we need whammos. Now, that's not exactly a technical term, but it's a good Hollywood term. It means impact. It means gut level. It could be sexual appeal, violence, a shock, something that really hits the audience in the guts. So he would look at a script and he says, not enough whammos. Or he would look at a cut of a film and he would say, no, the second reel needs another whammo. So we were in the whammo business. And now, again, I think we can see, in all respect to politics, it's a form of entertainment now. We just saw a season of whammos, didn't we? And they're still coming. And they're still coming. All right. So what can we do about this? Well, I think we need to recognize our obligation as mediators, as Christians. We need to have a better analysis, a diagnosis of what's going on, and I'm speaking to scholars here and like that. This is more your responsibility. We need better depth of understanding what's happening now. I think we could also start by examining our own anxieties and fears and visions among us. That would be, you know, we're living in this atmosphere of polarity and division. We're not going to escape it. We're not going to escape it. We need to address the potential divisions, and so we can address our own differences with respect and love, which I know we all want to do. Let me suggest what I see among American Catholics is basically three orientations now. The first would be, and these are all good friends of mine, the first would be those who completely disagree with my point of view. They would find my point of view too apocalyptic, too negative. They would say, no, the institutions of government and education are sound. They're good. They just need some reform. They just need to be made better. But there's no need for any basic big change going on. I won't linger on that one because I don't think that's held that strongly as it was at one time by the generation who deserved to think that way because they were the immigrants, the Catholic immigrants who built this country. I think the more prevalent point of view is what I would call the restorationist point of view. That is, those Catholics who say, okay, the institutions we can still keep, we can revive them, they still have tensile strength, but they need foundation. We need to go back and recover the moral and spiritual foundations of the country. A kind of moral revival, kind of the great awakenings of the past. I'm very sympathetic to this. But Then there are those of us, and I admit that I am sympathetic to this point of view, that have the point of view that's being described by some people as the Benedict option, usually negatively. When that term is used, it's used negatively. It comes actually from the last lines of Alistair MacIntyre's After Virtue, in which he looks into the future and he says, who knows, maybe it's going to be another Saint Benedict. And what is implied by this is a more independent, autonomous building of Catholic community. We need to step forward and work together. Now, this is usually understandably criticized as being too exclusive, maybe Gnostic, Manichaean, you know. And I can see the dangers in that. Certainly there's a danger of our, you know, trying to isolate ourselves. I don't think that should be the impulse. But I think what we need to do, and this could start with the artists, is we need to come together, join together, and create community that can be a model for others. None of these problems are going to be solved by abstractions. They're going to be, to the extent this country can be brought back together, it's got to become credible by other Americans looking at, say, people say, okay, look at them. Look how they're living. Looking how they're working together. I respect the reformers. I respect the restorationists. I don't think that's going to happen, frankly. And so what sounds like the most utopian, that we should really begin to build our own communities, identifiable Catholic communities in the work we do, I think is actually, from my point of view, the most realistic thing. But in any case, whatever we do, and I'm willing to help the reformers and the restorationists, I'll pitch in, sure. Whatever we do, let's recognize these divisions with mutual respect and love. Because if we can keep to the love that comes through Jesus and to the truth that comes through the Gospels, if we can put that love and truth together for others, we will have our own Catholic whammos.
Thank you very much. Our last speaker is Gregory Wolfe. And Gregory Wolfe is a senior fellow at the Institute for Catholic Thought and Culture at Seattle University. He's also the founder of Image, which is one of the country's leading literary journals that explores the relationship between faith and the arts. Please welcome Gregory Wolfe.
Thank you very much. At the end of the last session, there was a question that suggested that we might have an overeducated populace in light of the most recent election. I'm not entirely sure about that one. Maybe an over-credentialed populace, but the work of education continues. I'm very glad that the concept of the imagination has been so frequent here and not just relegated to our session on the arts. It's reassuring. I'm always insecure around philosophers and theologians, so I'm already feeling the interdisciplinary love. I will say that I do, as a writer and a publisher of writing, I share Velma's view of contemporary literary theory and contemporary literary study. But my work is actually focused in the area of new creative writing and the creation of new works of art, meaning that my focus is on today, not on the past. Or to put it in the words of the immortal Flip Wilson, mine is the church of what's happening now. And so I suppose in one sense, by definition, I'm a professional optimist. My work is to go out and find the art that's being made, the art that's worthy of attention, to say, the work is here, deal with it. Don't hide your head in the sand. Or in the immortal example of the famous Dr. Johnson, Dr. Samuel Johnson, when he was once challenged to respond to Bishop Berkeley's theory of idealism, in which the the world was really just an illusion in our minds, stepped towards the nearest rock and said, I refute it thus. I refute it thus. I point to the work itself. That's my job. So forgive me for a little bit of optimism here. I do think there are two fundamental problems with art in the context of the theme of this convocation. And these problems will further prove your suspicions that artists are thoroughly disreputable, subversive types. The first is that art, if it's really looked at carefully, mostly seems to work through evolution, to quote the word that Father Michael raised. Looking at any particular time period, and particularly the movement of one style to another, the method of art really seems to be patricide, the killing of the fathers, the revolution, the kind of overturning of what's come before. Just when we got to the High Renaissance, Leonardo and Michelangelo, then come the Mannerists, you know. So just when we have this kind of ideal of perfection and roundedness and kind of completeness and wholeness, come these artists who start contorting and twisting and elongating the world. I mean, they were bad Mannerists, if you ask me. Sorry, that's not a very good pun. Just when we have neoclassical order in the 18th century, we've got the Romantics to come and bollocks up the works and go frolicking among the daffodils. Art seems to work through revolution, through patricide and matricide. So how do we deal with that? Of course, the other issue raised by our theme is evangelization. And that's a word which I hope would give any artist, and maybe even most especially a Catholic artist, what we used to call the willies. Art is not about didacticism. If a work is didactic, it is no longer art. Art works through indirection, through the attraction toward the puzzling out of meaning of a complex, ambiguous work, not through the dispensing of propositional truth. So we already have two big problems between art and our theme. So let me tackle them each in turn. Stewardship, the whole idea of stewardship of knowledge. I think one of the things that always puzzles us about art, and most especially in our own time, is how to cope with these changing styles. Yes, when we look back towards the past, we're able to see things kind of smoothed out. Those individual shifts seemed smaller to us than they did at the time. I often try to get my students, though, to think about what it's actually like to be alive in any kind of liminal space between time periods. And the radical example I use is the one of what would you think if you were a group of Romanesque architects? You were the Romanesque Architect Club going to the very first Gothic church, right? You heard about this new church and you went in and you were used to the beautiful rounded arch which symbolized perfection and eternity and the solidity of the Roman Empire. And you, because you couldn't make very big windows in that form of architecture, the darkness and mystery of God. And then you walk into the very first Gothic church and you go, oh my eyes! And you look at these pointy little arches with their instability and their kind of effeminate sort of non-strong kind of mode, and you think this is weak and this is pathetic, and yet we look back from our point of view and we think of the medieval era as a single era, an era of absolute harmony, but those guys would have been beating each other up in the alley behind Saint-Denis, believe me. But especially in our own time, the great Time magazine art critic Robert Hughes called the shock of the new. And it's always most difficult for us to deal with the present moment because the present moment hasn't been digested. We don't have that perspective on it anymore. And so we tend to be tempted towards the narrative of decline. The work of the present moment doesn't match up to the great heroes of the past. We haven't had time to step back and see what will last. That's natural. So there's an element of it that's commonsensical, but there's also an element of alienation. towards the notion that we live in a modern era. Well, every era's present moment was modern to them. And so I think one of the things that really sets us off is a lack of understanding of how arts language changes and why it changes and why it must change. And I think to really cut the topic short because of time restraints, it's very simple. One of the reasons why art has to proceed by revolution is that we are fallen creatures. We use a language for a while and it becomes hardened and calcified. The truth, which is elusive, escapes it because it becomes rote and repetitious. And to some extent, we need revolution. And again, I think the role of history is important. Even if you were to take a look at high modernism, the shocking world of high modernism, think most especially, I think classically, of the premiere of The Rite of Spring by Igor Stravinsky. When The Rite of Spring came out, it caused a riot. There were people sort of taking each other's top hats and smashing them down over each other's heads and whipping out their sword canes and challenging each other to duels and throwing tomatoes onto the platform. There was this notion that the music, which was full of dissonance, was decadent and primitive. And yet, in the light of history, it's possible to step back. And it's possible, for example, to step back and look at Stravinsky himself and understand, when you look at his biography and you look at his music as a whole, that he was an incredible traditionalist whose favorite composer was Mozart, who pointed out that dissonance was not something he invented, that there's plenty of dissonance in Mozart if you know where to hear it, and what dissonance can do for us to balance out our appreciation of harmony. And you can look at the way Stravinsky returned to his Eastern Orthodox faith and the way that he cited tradition. So again, history gives us some perspective on these things. I think at a deeper level, what Stravinsky was doing, what T.S. Eliot was doing, what D.H. Lawrence was doing, what Pablo Picasso were doing in this high modernist period was responding to a world that had lost a sense of religious awe and mystery and the sacred, and increasingly etherealized it in a kind of world of ideal paintings of nymphs and goddesses frolicking around. They were realizing that faith and religion and the sacred had been sentimentalized and abstracted away. And there was a desire to get back to blood and flesh and sexuality and a kind of inchoate desire for an incarnate vision of the world. And so you get D.H. Lawrence's sex mysticism, you get Pablo Picasso's Les Demoiselles d'Avignon, you get The Rite of Spring, you get T.S. Eliot's return to his interest in Buddhism and Hinduism, his interest in sort of the primitive and the kind of primal. And again, we can see this in perspective. Now we see someone like Eliot and Stravinsky, we see, oh, they're safe, they became Christians. But nonetheless, at heart, that era was still longing for something powerfully religious, the powerful religious questions. And this is one of the things about art that kind of reminds us of continuity is an important value, but continuity sometimes involves a kind of historical leapfrogging. That sometimes the way that we reappropriate the past is not by continuing it, but by going back behind. One of my favorite quotes is by the late Cardinal Henri de Lubac, who suggested that to get away from things that parade themselves as tradition and which are ultimately just rote, calcified, static, inert things, we need to go back to the most distant past, which will reveal itself to us as the nearest present. I think that's true in the arts. I think it's true in theology. I mean, the Neo-Thomists went back to Thomas. Von Balthasar and the Ressourcement went back to the patristics. This is the nature of how tradition becomes a living thing, is some of this revolution, some of this antagonism. It is part of a larger, deeper sense of what appropriating a tradition and what stewardship should mean. Tradition is a living thing. Many of you know Yaroslav Pelikan's famous quote, "Tradition is the living faith of the dead." Traditionalism is the dead faith of the living. But he goes on to say very interestingly, tradition lives in conversation with the past while remembering where we are and when we are, and that it is we who have to decide. I love that. Tradition lives in conversation with the past, remembering where we are and when we are. Traditionalism supposes that nothing should ever be done for the first time, so that all that is needed to solve any problem is to arrive at the supposedly unanimous testimony of this homogenized tradition. That's not tradition. That's traditionalism. That's the ideology of tradition. That's not the living tradition. And it was T.S. Eliot who really reminded us of the importance of understanding tradition as a continuity that involves us. You can't step off of history and look at history from some Archimedean point. You are part of that tradition, and your own perspective is fundamental. Father Michael spoke about speaking to the age. Well, the way that we learn how to speak to the age is by recognizing that we are of this age. We may be critical of this age. We may have a critical perspective on the age that perhaps releases us from some of its worst errors, but to deny that we breathe the air of the age, that we are naturally coming from the place that is dominated by the characteristics of the age would be naive and dangerous and certainly not an example of Christian humility. So Eliot's famous essay, "The Tradition and the Individual Talent," reminds us that the poet of the present moment changes the tradition. The new work that comes out enables us to see all the past in a different light. It's as if all these past works are sort of panels that all slightly turn when we create the new work. I think one way to look at culture is to remember of the importance of needing to actually make new culture. And to not be so despairing about the time we live that we step back and we become critics only, we become spectators, not participants in the life of our own culture, in the making of new culture. Now, finally, with regard to evangelization, this very scary word, I very much appreciated Sister Barbara's opening words about that our work is less about managing truths we offer than a willingness to be challenged by them as well, which reminded me again of another quote by Cardinal de Lubac, who said, "When I teach my brother, it is not really I who teach him, but we are both taught by God. Truth is not a good that I possess, that I manipulate and distribute as I please. It is such that in giving, I must still receive it. In discovering it, I must still search for it. In adapting it, I must continually adapt myself to it." I think that is one of the things that art teaches us. Art involves, as you know, a process both of a body of knowledge that the artist has and a body of skills, the habitus of art. But it also involves this mystery of creation, this mystery of improvisation of the new. Any great writer that you come across will ultimately say something to the effect that, "I didn't know what I thought until I wrote." That it is in the act of making that we are able to acquire knowledge. And I think this is very fundamental if we're to avoid a notion of truth as propositional and static and inert, and understand truth as a process, as a dynamic of giving and receiving at the same time. Well, I'm out of time. I would just say that as far as the evangelization is concerned, there is plenty out there for us to see. I think one of the reasons that I find my work difficult is I will cite the work that's being made, but people have already drawn the veil over their sight about the current world. I can talk about Terrence Malick and Martin Scorsese. I can talk about TV programs like Rectify. I can talk about novelists like Marilyn Robinson and Cormac McCarthy, or writers like Christian Wiman, Mary Carr, Jeffrey Hill, Thomas Trans-Tromer. I can talk about the amazing rise of African literature with writers like U.M. Akpan, Chigozie Obioma, Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie. writers who are sincerely grappling with issues of faith. And it's difficult to get a hearing. So I would ask that we would all believe that this making of culture, this act of making, is as important as the critiquing and thinking and trying to understand that, and that tradition is a living, breathing entity, and that evangelization ultimately, as Cardinal Ratzinger said, as Philip quoted, comes from an attraction to something very concrete, a witness of beauty. And that, in my opinion, is really ultimately the best definition of art, which is a kind of bearing witness. Thank you very much.